today we turn to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, 16 through 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, to the close of the age." This is the reading of the word.
You speak of God.
I feel a little irreverent sitting down reading the scriptures, right? You know, it was the tradition of the ages that when you read from the gospel, not only did the minister stand, but the congregation stood. You all would kill me. But this scripture in Matthew is one that we all know, right? We who call ourselves people of faith should know it. It's a quoted scripture, right? "Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that I have commanded." You can put that one on a wall. We're commissioned. This is the Great Commission. The problem with commission is that it takes work. I don't know how many of you have ever worked at a commission job. Who's worked by commission? Who hates working by commission? Because to get the commission, to get the result, you have to work harder. It is a trend right now. I don't know where this trend is heading. It is a trend that drives me absolutely bonkers. But it is the self-made entrepreneurial deal. And sometimes it's wonderful. Like, I love my La Rio Hello in it. And I love that they're different. But then there are others where it's like, how many are there? We've got clothing. We've got makeup. We've got fitness. We've got vitamins. We've got life planning, life coaches, life this, shakes. I mean, it can all come across your email, your newsfeed, your best friend, the little vendor. I love our vendor fair, but golly gracious, sometimes, right? Almost all of those positions are commissioned positions. You buy a product, you sell a product, and you only get a specific percentage. And then if you are able to get people to work under you, who work in your network, you then get a portion of their profits, and it ups your commission. Now that's a simplified over deal, but it's what we're called to do. Did you know that? We're not, as Christians, on a salary. Because who knows, salary positions are the ones you want, right? Particularly those salary positions where they seem to just come in and sit at their handy-dandy, lovely little desk, and they put things on it to make it look like they're working, but you really know that they're playing solitaire on their computer. Don't we want that one. But that's not what Christ calls us to do. I have deep respect for those who are able to do the jobs that they do. Because it takes work. You see, in order to make money, in order to make a commission, you have to approach people. Even if it makes you uncomfortable. You have to tell them what you're doing. You have to say, this is why what I'm doing is so wonderful and awesome and why you need it too. I have a dear friend who sells It's Worth, and she put something on her page thing. And it was, why are we so supportive of the big box corporations and we're not supportive of the small entrepreneur? Particularly when that entrepreneur is our friend. And I think it's because we forget that this is the call of which we are called to do. You see, as people of God, that's what we're supposed to do. We are called to go forth and make disciples. We're called to go forth and say, this is what the gospel is, and this is what the gospel is telling us. Let me share this with you. Let me, dare I say, sell this to you. So that you can then go and share the good news. It's a network. See, Christ began with 12 disciples. Those 12 disciples then discipled other people. Those who were discipled then discipled other people. It was a network, a chain reaction, if you will. So why, then, is it so difficult? I mean, it's a simple command. Christ only gives us a couple of things that we're supposed to do. Paul takes those and expands on them and gives us a much longer list. But Christ, he wants us to come to the table. We do that very, very well. We're disciples. What's at the center of our sanctuary and worship? Mm-hmm. He wants us to be baptized. How many of us have been baptized? Check. We're doing good. Now, how many of us have gone forth and made disciples? And that does not mean by having them physically, or else I would be above you all. You see, we're really, really good at the one we do every week. And we're really, really good at the one that's made special. Right? Because how many of us can remember our baptisms and the significance of that particular thing? Or if you were baptized as an infant, you remember your confirmation? That was a big deal, right? But then some point, at some way in our faith, we must go from being the one who is fed to being the one who feeds. I'll never forget when Sophia was born. And you're holding this little child and you realize, oh man, where's the adult? Because suddenly, when we get home and everyone else is gone, you know, because who had their mom stay with them for the first week or so? And they did all the cooking and the cleaning and the awesomeness. Thank you for moms. Because then suddenly that mom is gone, and you go, oh, wait, I gotta fix dinner too? I think at some point we forget that this is part of the command of Christ. That yes, we have to do it too. There's a really old saying that the church is only one generation from dying. You want to know why? It's because we do not fulfill this commission. It's because we do not take it onto ourselves to foster a relationship. You see, because that's all that this is all about. The entire Bible is about relationships. The relationship of God with the people of God. The relationship of God, not just with the people in a general sense, but with us. You cannot fall back on a relationship if you do not have it. You cannot rely on another's part in life if you do not have a relationship with them. So where does it begin? But here. You see, we start here. You know why I love Vacation Bible School? Get them young. Because it's a proven statistical fact over and over and over again that children who are raised in the church, who continue to have positive relationships with more than just their parents or grandparents in the church, will continue to be part of the body of the church. Maybe not the one they grew up in. But the church. Because one of the hardest things I think as a church to realize is that this isn't specific. It doesn't say go and make therefore disciples for this particular room, for this particular sanctuary, for this particular denomination. It says, go and make disciples of all nations. Baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach them to observe all I commanded, and I will be with you always to the close of the age. You see, one of the hardest things about commission is when it bears fruit. You see, when we put forth effort, we want to see the result, right? I can't deny I love my paycheck. Right? Who doesn't? And when you work on commission, you get, and you sit there and you figure, and you go, oh wait, hold on, okay, I get paid. I did this amount of effort in the first quarter, and so I get that paycheck at the start of the second quarter, right? Or at least that's how it was for me when I worked on commission. It was whatever my first quarter were, 3 months worth of work that I did not see my commission check until the beginning of that second quarter. Except, oh wait, hold on, there's a caveat. Because you have your first 90-day trial period, right? So in reality, I had 6 months of that backup commission. Now I earned a small wage to augment and to make it worth my while. Holy gracious. But when you're putting all that effort and energy in, and you don't see an instantaneous result, how many of us get discouraged? Kind of like a diet. I I love the meme that says, I started my diet today, I ate salad, and when I stepped on the scale in the afternoon, nothing had changed, and so I went back to my donuts, my coffee, my cake, right? The Great Commission does not talk about the instantaneous result. It doesn't even talk about a result that we can see. It talks about the result that God can see. It talks about us as people of faith being the avatars of God. That's a fun word, isn't it? Avatar. It means that you are not working for yourself, but for something greater than you. Who's seen that movie? It's wonderful. It's where the gentleman, like literally his mind and all of his senses and everything are put into the form of another. Why do we struggle so much with this? I think of the churches of the ancient past, the amount of time that it took to build. To those who have not gone to Europe and looked at the great cathedrals in and around, it is worth a trip if able, and if not, go to Google. It took years. I think one of the downfalls of our societal understanding and our American understanding of Christian faith is sometimes that we forget about constancy. We forget that it is not a generational thing. We will not see the fulfillment of the end times if we do not put forth the effort and the age. Because the Gospels, when they were written, they wanted Jesus to come right back here and there, right? That's the entirety of the New Testament. It is looking for Jesus coming again, not in some far distant future, but then and now. And here we are 2,000 plus years later, and we still live in this thought and reality. We want it now. And yet, the Great Commission calls us not to now, but to forever. Because when we have called people to faith, when we have shared the good news and the gospel, it is not about us, it is about God. It is not about what results we can see, the number of people we can say, oh, I brought that person to God. You know, one of the hardest struggles for me in college was the conversations that we would have as part of crew. The conversations we would have with people, and then we would go back and look at our follow-up card and go, oh, I told them the gospel. Check. And in some ways I struggled with it, but now, in hindsight of life, I see the benefit of it, because the more people we can check off and say, at least I shared the gospel with, the more we can hold ourselves accountable to this commission so that it might not be us. And I think we struggle with that one a lot, right? We want it to be us from beginning to end. We want it to be us who says, oh, I showed you the way and the truth and the light. But you see, we're not Jesus. Jesus says that. The entirety of our purpose here is to go and make disciples, to show them who Jesus is so that Jesus can show them who God is. So the result, my friends, the prayer of our faith is that we will recognize that we have been commissioned. do in each and every engagement that we have with one another and with other people, that we will share this good news. This great commission, it's not an individual thing. You see, because in discipleship, we all benefit more when there are more to fall on. You gain more understanding the more you have, the more people you can hold yourself in relationship with, the richer your relationship with God will be. Think about it. We start with Jesus, right? Jesus who points us towards God. And Jesus began with the 12. And the 12 went on and on. And it all leads back up. Because you know that pyramid effect? That it all goes back up and it builds back up to Christ. It's something to think about. It's something to dwell on. Because summer is here. Right? If you didn't know, look around you. And in the summer, we have unique opportunities. Vacation Bible School is just one such opportunity. And at the end of the summer, we close out with our family fun day. But in between, who takes vacation? Maybe, right? Who heads to camp? Who goes to the beach? Or the river? Or the mountains, or the valleys. And who stays at home? But sees different people and experiences different, unique opportunities if you look for them. Because it's not me who commissions. It is Christ. It's not the church who commissions. It is Christ. And it all comes back together and connects to one another so that where we are, the gospel is. So go. Go forth. Oh, wait, you didn't hear that one from me yet, had you? Oh, that was our theme last year for Regional Assembly. I've already preached on this text several times in the last year. But each time you read it, it's something new, right? We're called to go forth